Hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. Good morning, today is Thursday, December 7, 2023. Today in history, 127 years ago today, the modern Chinese writer Yu Dafu was born. Renowned for works such as Qinluan, Sinking, Guda de Qiao, Autumn of Capital, and Chunfeng Chenzui de Wanchang, Intoxicating Spring Nights. Yu Dafu is recognized as one of the founders of the new literary group Creation Society. His literary approach is characterized by the belief that literary works are autobiographies of writers, leading him to candidly portray his thoughts, emotions, and life experiences in his creations. Qingqiao, bridging the business world and delivering information to you. Welcome to today's Qingqiao Morning News. Let's start with political updates. Ho Chi Minh City and St. Petersburg promote cooperation in multiple fields. Vietnam News Agency report, on December 4, Vice Chairman of the People's Committee of Ho Chi Minh City, Vo Van Hoen, conducted a working meeting with Yevgeny Grigoriev, Chairman of the Committee for External Relations of St. Petersburg, and his accompanying delegation. Vo Van Hoen, Vice Chairman of Ho Chi Minh City's People's Committee, expressed that there is ample opportunity for further cooperation and development between Ho Chi Minh City and St. Petersburg. He aims to strengthen the friendly cooperative ties initiated since 2005. Vietnam expressed its willingness to boost collaboration with St. Petersburg in trade, education, and health. Ho Chi Minh City aims to facilitate local enterprises entering the St. Petersburg market and enhance the living standards of its residents. Both parties aim to strengthen cultural exchanges and people-to-people diplomacy. The St. Petersburg government's Foreign Affairs Committee chairman hopes for the prompt signing of relevant cooperation agreements. Secondly, we'll bring you updates on military-related news. Israeli ground operations expand to cover Gaza. Comprehensive news from Gaza on December 3, a spokesperson for the Israeli military announced that the Israel Defense Forces are resuming and expanding ground operations against Hamas strongholds throughout the Gaza Strip. He emphasized that the Israeli Air Force is conducting airstrikes on Hamas's headquarters, weapons manufacturing facilities, tunnels, and rocket launch sites, offering crucial support to ground forces. Israel also released a statement on social media, urging Gaza civilians to promptly evacuate from the southern city of Khan Yunis and certain adjacent areas, seeking refuge in regions nearer to the Egyptian border and the Mediterranean Sea. However, local residents argued that there is no safe haven in Gaza, as even the city of Rafah was targeted by airstrikes. Amos Yadlin, the former Israeli military intelligence director, informed the media that Israel has accomplished approximately 30% of its mission to overthrow the Hamas regime. The ongoing conflict is anticipated to extend for weeks to months, with Khan Yunis playing a crucial role. As hostilities resume in Gaza, the destiny of Hamas remaining hostages has become more precarious. The British Ministry of Defense confirmed that the British military will conduct reconnaissance flights over Gaza to aid in the search for hostages. India agrees to withdraw troops from Maldives. According to CCTV News, on December 3, Maldivian President Mohamed Muaiz held a press conference where he publicly stated that the Indian government has agreed to withdraw its troops from the Maldives Islands and has now entered the technical process of withdrawal. Previously, during the presidential election held in the Maldives, the Maldivian people demanded that Mohamed Muaiz, who was still the presidential candidate, ask India to withdraw its troops to respect the democratic will of the Maldivian people. In 1988, a coup occurred in the Maldives. India sent troops to help the Maldives resolve the crisis, and the two countries established a close and friendly cooperative relationship. The Indian Army was invited to help the Maldives train its military to deal with future security challenges, and Indian military personnel have remained in the Maldives to this day. Regarding the issue of garrisoning troops, India has repeatedly defended itself, saying that there are only 75 people remaining on the Maldives island and they will not pose a threat to the Maldives. However, local people in the Maldives pointed out that the real number of troops stationed was far more than 75, and they also discovered that India was deploying weapons. Muais said the two countries decided to establish a high-level bilateral committee to replace the role of Indian military personnel and address the challenges encountered in the execution of various Indian-funded projects in the Maldives, especially to speed up the construction of key projects such as bridges. Now, let's turn our attention to the latest economic news. Thailand plans to expand Nong Khai Special Economic Zone. According to ASEAN Financial News, on December 3, Thai Deputy Prime Minister Phumthamwet Chiachai said in an interview after the cabinet meeting that the Thai government intends to merge Udon Thani and Nong Khai into a large special economic zone. One of the main topics at the cabinet meeting was to discuss expanding the scope of the Nong Khai Special Economic Zone to cover the Udon Thani Industrial Park, so that manufacturers in the Udon Thani Industrial Park can enjoy the same rights and benefits as those in the Nong Khai Special Economic Zone. It is understood that Nong Khai Special Economic Zone is one of Thailand's border special economic zones. It is located on the south bank of the Mekong River in northeastern Thailand, close to Laos. There are 249 investment projects in the zone, with a total investment of 11.8 billion baht. The authorities stated that the merger of Udon Thani province and Nong Khai province into a large special economic zone is to combine the strengths of both parties and strengthen the economic engine role of border trade and cross-border trade, so as to drive economic growth across Thailand. The government will fully support and promote this merger plan to maximize its effects. Cambodia's de-dollarization has achieved initial results. According to the Cambodia-China Times, the Baikon payment system has seen significant growth. As of 2021, the number of Baikon system users reached 7.9 million, with a transaction volume of 8.17 million. The transactions were divided into 20.1% in Cambodian currency and 79.9% in US dollars, accounting for 13.87% of GDP. Baikon was created by the Bank of Cambodia to encourage the use of the national currency and electronic payments while enhancing interconnection among financial institutions, and was officially launched in October 2020. Cambodia was once highly dollarized, with US dollar transactions comprising over 90% of the economy. Recent data indicates initial progress in de-dollarization. According to Chia Seri, governor of the National Bank of Cambodia, the country's stable political situation over the past two decades has bolstered confidence in the national currency. The current circulation of the Cambodian riel has surged to 14.5 trillion, marking a 16-fold increase since 2000. However, achieving full de-dollarization in the Cambodian economy remains a long-term goal. Now, here is some important safety information. Explosion in southern Philippines kills 4 and injures 54. According to reports from Manila on December 3, an explosion occurred during a Catholic mass at the gymnasium of the University of Mindanao in Marawi City, southern Philippines, killing at least 4 people and injuring 54 others. Following the incident, the school announced the suspension of classes, and local military and police were on high alert, making efforts to apprehend the culprit and prevent further incidents. Military police explosives experts are still analyzing the type of bomb used in the attack. After gathering information from victims, local officials stated that the bomb device was remotely detonated through a mobile phone. On December 4, the Philippine police identified at least 2 suspects in the bombing, and the terrorist organization Islamic State claimed responsibility for the attack. Marawi, located in the economically challenged Moro Autonomous Region of Mindanao, has long been plagued by crime, separatist violence, and gang conflicts. Extremist elements have taken advantage of the situation. In May 2017, the Abu Sayyaf and Maute groups, pledging allegiance to the Islamic State, occupied Marawi. The military engaged in a 5-month battle before regaining control of the city. In recent years, it has remained a focal point for religious conflicts in the area. Finally, here's some intriguing cultural news. Opening of the first Festival of Culture, Sports and Tourism of Ethnic Groups in the Central Highlands, 2023. According to Vietnam News Agency, recently the first festival of culture, sports and tourism of ethnic groups in the Central Highlands opened in Kon Tum Province. The tourism festival, themed Great Central Highlands, Converging Essence, brought together nearly 600 performers and athletes from 5 provinces in the Central Highlands region, Kon Tum, Gia Lai, Dak Lak, Dak Nong, and Lam Dong. The event aimed to showcase the region's renewed vitality and the communicative power of its cultural space in contemporary life. During the tourism festival, the local government showcased the traditional cultural customs of various ethnic groups in the Central Highlands region. The event also featured the promotion of traditional cultural products from different provinces in the region, along with various cultural and artistic activities, including traditional ethnic costume shows. Vietnam has expressed its commitment to prioritizing the comprehensive and sustainable development of the Central Highlands, emphasizing the integration of local culture with modern elements to enhance cultural expressions and attract international tourists. Financial newsletter. According to Chihua Daily, recently, WTI January crude oil futures closed down $1.03, or 1.39%, at $73.04 per barrel. Brent crude oil futures for February closed down 85 cents, or 1.08%, at $78.03 per barrel. That's all for today's Qingqiao Morning News. Thank you for listening.